question for you. What's today? Don't tell me it's Sunday. Someone made the box. What's today? Mother's Day! Don't say it on the board, you know, does it? What does it say on the board, Tim? It's the fourth Sunday of Easter. What are we going to celebrate here today, I wonder? You know how the beans are chosen, I don't know if you know this, there is what's called a lectionary. A lectionary is a list of readings. With Vatican II, the Roman Catholic Church changed the list from just 1 year cycle to a 3 year cycle, just New Testament, and Old Testament as well. And then pretty much all the other major denominations followed along and took that, tweaked it a little bit, and called it the Revised Common Lectionary. That's what we use to determine what Sunday beings are going to use. For example, this is year A, the first year cycle, and it's obviously the fourth Sunday of Easter. Now, if you were to go and look at the lectionary, do you suppose you might find something called Mother's Day?
No.
There is no Sunday called Mother's Day. Now, there are Sundays, or there are days, in the lectionary, because it's not just Sundays, where we do celebrate mothers. Do you want to make a stab at which one in particular?
Magdalene.
Mary, Mother of Jesus. Blessed Virgin Mary. So that's an obvious one. But there's no specific Sunday for Mother's Day. Now let me ask you another question. What are the three highest attending Sundays of the year? Christmas, Easter, Mother's Day. Pentecost doesn't even rank as the third great festival of the year, supposedly. The national secular calendar does in fact have a Mother's Day, doesn't it? It's always the second Sunday of May. And so the question that most preachers have to face on this approaching this day is, well, what should I talk about? There are some clergy who adopt what I describe as the Hallmark strategy. What do you suppose that might be? To talk about Mother's Day and mothers, right? And that's a good thing to do. But that's exactly what I'm going to do. But mine isn't the Hallmark strategy, as you'll discover. The danger with a Hallmark strategy is that it becomes rather overly sentimental. And part of the problem with that is that not all of us have had a great relationship with our mothers. I mean, some of us didn't, in fact, even know one of us. I was having a conversation with Wick earlier on about that. So it can be a little tricky. But let's have a little conversation about Mother's Day, which doesn't involve the Hallmark strategy, shall we? So where do you suppose it comes from originally? How far back do you want to go?
100 years?
1,000 years?
19th century,
okay. Well, some scholars will tell you that you can trace the origins of Mother Day back to the ancient Greeks, and in particular the celebration of the festival of Sibyl. It doesn't look like Sybil, but it is Sybil, trust me. And that was the day when mothers were celebrated. The goddess Sybil was the mother of the gods, and so you can see how you could then take the next step and celebrate mothers based on that. So that's the first thing. The Romans took that up, and as with the Romans loved everything Greek. But they just took it over and they renamed it. So for them, it became the festival of Juno, which is where we get the month of June from. And I've often wondered that maybe we should have Mother's Day in June, because then we'll be connected to that. However, on that day, Romans gave their mothers gifts. So that's the first origin that you might think of as an origin of Mother's Day, and I suppose you could recast it as mother as goddess. So, okay, how many of you mothers out there would like to be worshipped as goddesses? And maybe a few guilty kids here who are trying to do that just this day as well. It works for Hallmark, doesn't it? And florists and the candy companies. And I don't mention those casually, because those three form a nexus which actually has affected what Mother's Day has become, because that's not how it began. So there's a second place that you could look at. It is in the 19th century. And there are three women in particular who are responsible for what we call Mother's Day. Anyone know anything? Mothers should be doing some research about it. So the first one is a woman named Anna Jarvis. And she lived in the Appalachian part of this country. She was born in the early part of the 19th century. And she came to Custer Commons in the Civil War era. And Anna was what you would call today a social activist, a community organizer. You know, use that phrase, it means something. That's what she was. She got Appalachian women together into groups. And she had a specific name for those groups. It was the Mother's Day Friendship Circle. And what they did, this wasn't a let's all mothers get together and sew up the baptismal garment stuff. This was, how do we address poverty in Appalachia? So the Mother's Day War Clubs were intentionally formed by Anna Jarvis and then mothers to try and address social issues, most particularly poverty. The Civil War came along and they morphed into something else. They became kind of medical camps where they would treat any soldier, north or south. It wasn't that they didn't care, they cared especially that they would treat soldiers both north and south, because they wanted to make a statement about the war. And following the war, Jarvis, and this is the first time you hear this, Jarvis organized something called the Mother's Day Friendship Day. The Mother's Day Friendship Day. What do you suppose that was about? They brought together people from the north and people from the south to try and encourage reconciliation. So Mother's Day has its roots in reconciliation and peace. And Anna Jarvis is the person that you would look to find that. Okay, the second person is a woman named Julia Ward Howe. Other than David, who keeps mouth shut, anyone know who that is? Mine eyes have seen the glory of the coming of the Lord. You know what that is, right? Bad Hebrew Prophet, she wrote that. Not the music, she wrote the books to that. And she wrote it when she visited the army of the Potomac when it was in its winter quarters. And so she saw the army of the Western dudes and dads. But that was, since it was in winter quarters, that was a time when there was not a lot of violence going on. And the irony of this is that while it comes to the Battle of the Republic, she came very much to oppose the Civil War. She was most especially appalled by the loss of life. And what that did was radicalize her. And so she also became a social activist. She was involved after the Civil War in numerous social issues, and here's a list of them. Which is really impressive. Issues of peace and war, anti-slavery, voting rights for women, health issues, disease prevention, equal rights for all, child protection, labor laws, safe working conditions. She becomes more and more radicalized. Can you see that as that happens? And again, we would call her today a social activist or a community organizer. And why did she do this? Because she believed that women had a special responsibility, especially mothers, to seek to shape society for good. To seek to shape society for good. Because, she said, God demanded no less. So that's another feature which she and Jarvis shared, which was they were active and devout Christians. Active and devout Christians. 1870 comes around and she wrote something which is known as the Mother's Day Proclamation, in which she implored women and especially mothers everywhere to come together, and this is what she said. This is only part of that proclamation. She said, "Arise then, women of this day, as men have often forsaken the plow and the anvil at the summons of war, let women now leave all that may be left of home for a great and earnest day of counsel." Well, what she was saying was, we need to get together and start to work for peace and reconciliation because the men have screwed this up for you. That's essentially what she was saying. We come to the third person, and you'll recognize the name. It's just slightly different. Anna Jarvis. Anna Jarvis was Anne Jarvis's mother. She wasn't as active as her mother. But she did, in 1907, go to the pastor of her church, St. Andrew's Methodist Episcopal Church, and say, we should have a day celebrating mothers. This is based on all that's gone before, when she knew also Julia Ward Howe. of her mother and children will know. We should have a special day. We should have a special day. Look, May 12 is coming up. That's what she said. And so on May 12, because pastors listen to mothers when they come and talk to them, always, always, May 12 was the first Mother's Day. And now that was the second Sunday of May. And that's why we now celebrate Mother's Day on the second Sunday of May. Now that was supposed to be a one-off, but it was wildly successful. And so the next year, she came back and said to the pastor, we should have a day celebrating mothers. Why don't we do it on the same day? And why don't we give out white carnations so that everyone who is wearing a white carnation is identified as someone who is committed to peace and reconciliation. That's where the flowers come from. Now, the flower industry has done a pretty good job of, you know, tweaking that so that you actually don't know that anymore. But that's where that comes from. Within 7 years, Woodrow Wilson convinces Congress to pass a resolution declaring the second Sunday of May every year as Mother's Day. It's a wonderful example that you would never see today of the President and Congress working together. Mothers are involved in that, isn't that interesting? And so that's where the National Mother's Day comes from. That's the day we celebrate today, the second Sunday of May. That's the history of that Mother's Day. That's almost the history. It's a little bit more. So now you have these two visions. It's mother as goddess, or mother as social activist and agent of change. It is absolutely true that greeting card companies, florists, and candy companies worked actively to subvert the second vision. Mother is a social activist. Because Mother's Goddess sells a lot more greeting cards, candy, and flowers. And so they intentionally set out to subvert this. Now, within a few years of Mother's Day, Anna Jarvis opposed its continuing. Now, before I tell you more about that, I just want to say something. Where does that leave us? Because I'm not going to tell all you children out there that you shouldn't celebrate your mothers, maybe not the goddesses. You shouldn't celebrate your mothers because we should celebrate our parents as much as we're able to do so. Not everyone is able to do that. We have received great gifts from them. My mother has been dead for 30 years. I still think back on the wonderful things that she did for me. That means some of the other things which weren't so great. But she did wonderful things. She was a single mother. She worked really hard. So I would say, first of all, go forth on this day and celebrate Mother's Day. But also remember the true origins of this day. Today is not only, in fact, it's not even primarily a day for us to celebrate our mothers. It's really, more importantly, a challenge to all of us, every person who has a mother, as well as every mother, to live in a way which calls for reconciliation and peace. What happened with Anna Jarvis is that she actually went to President Woodrow Wilson and tried to get him to stop doing that. She tried to stop him doing that because what had happened was that an anti-Semitic movement, and there was one at the time, spoke out against women who were working for peace. And what they did was they said, essentially, it's a bunch of men, frankly, or women who have become patriarchally identified. Basically, women should be at home looking after the kids. They shouldn't be out in the world trying to change it. And they actually were pretty successful at that. And that's why Jarvis tried to prevent Mother's Day from continuing in the form that it was in. And where does that leave us, though, with Mother's Day? Because look at the world that we live in. We live in a world where rape remains a weapon of war. Where, in a nation where we invented practically the murder suicide, which is almost always, 99% of the time, a man killing his wife, and sometimes the kids as well, and himself, as a method of control. It's always about control. If I can't control you, then I'm not going to let you live. We live in communities across this nation where single mothers continue to struggle to feed, clothe, and house their children. Almost all of the single parents in this country are women. So, on one level, I think we have to acknowledge that we really can't afford the time only to focus on this day as a day when we celebrate our mothers in a kind of a goddess mode. We need more to be thinking about it as a day when we all take up the cause of peace, because peace through justice can only be achieved when all people come together to work for it. So here we are. When you see flowers given to mothers, think of them as symbols. Think of them as symbols for the work that remains to be done. Work for peace. Work for justice. Work for equality. Work for God. Remember, these women who started this were doing so because they were Christians. That is, I think, a richer and more real view of this day. So see it as a call to participate in beating swords into pruning hooks. A call to participate, not just to say, oh, wouldn't it be nice if. The day when we seek to bring about that time when, to use the metaphor, the lion will lie down on the land. Don't just think of that as a good thing, wouldn't it be good if, but work for it. And I would say also, do so in the face of those cynics who are going to say, well, yeah, what can a small group of people do? Small group of people can't do anything. That's what the cynics will tell you. There's a woman named Margaret Mead. You know who Margaret Mead was? Margaret Mead was perhaps the greatest social anthropologist of the day. Margaret Mead, incidentally, you may not know this, Margaret Mead was an active Episcopalian, and she was one of the people who helped to write the baptismal covenant. So every time you say those responses, I will have gone south, think of Margaret Mead, because she was one of the people who really pushed for that. Margaret Mead was once asked a question along those lines, what do you say to all those people who say that a small group of people can't do this? And this is what she said. Never doubt that a small group of thoughtful, committed people can change the world. And then she said, indeed, it is the only thing that ever has. It is the only thing that ever has. So this is a day which marks the continuing of this struggle for peace and for justice. For what really lies at the heart of Mother's Day. A day which invites all mothers, and everyone who has one, I should add, to again take up the banner of Christ and to carry on the holy